don't know what I'm saying anymore.
Oh, it's different. Different. It's weird.
I've lost the plot. I can't even remember the words. Talk amongst yourselves. Hello everybody and welcome to Inside Number 23, my podcast which is all about sewing and knitting and my crafty life in general. My name is Katie, thank you so much for joining me today. You can find me on all of the social medias as Miss Lavelli, and we also have a Ravelry group for the podcast which is full of amazing, lovely, chatty people. So please go on and head over to Ravelry, just search Inside Number 23 podcast in the groups tab and you will find our group. So yeah, you may have noticed, guys, I'm actually coming to you from a different location today. Ooh, exciting. I decided to mix things up a little bit this week. I have very excitingly purchased a new stand for my phone. For those of you who don't know, I record this podcast currently on my iPhone 6, but until recently I didn't actually have any form of stand for that, so I was making do with propping up my phone on my computer, balanced on various books, balanced on my bed, which therefore meant that I was recording in our bedroom, sitting on a little puff, a little futon at the end of our bed, and that's how I've been podcasting. But now that I've got this fancy schmancy little stand to go on my tripod, I'm no longer restricted to just being able to record on something that is at a certain height. So I thought it might be fun to come to you from my sewing room today. It's a much more interesting background, I think, as you can see my various yarny goodness and my fabric-y goodness just behind me. Thought it might be a little bit more aesthetically pleasing for you guys. So let me know what you think. I'm keen to know your thoughts and your opinions. So let me know in the comments below. This week, Inside Number 23, it's been relatively interesting. So much stuff seems to be going on this week. I know, for example, that Tour de Fleece started this week, which is a spinning challenge that runs alongside the Tour de France. And a lot of my friends are getting involved, which is so exciting. I myself do have a drop spindle, which I've shown on a total of one episode of this podcast so far. And Tour de Fleece is definitely something I'd like to do in the future. But as yet, I'm still trying to just get to grips with the basics of spinning. So I shall just be being inspired by all of you amazing spinners during this Tour de Fleece, I think. Also, I know that it was Canada Day recently. So happy Canada Day to all of my Canadian viewers. And tomorrow is the 4th of July. So that's super exciting. So yeah, it's all going on and it feels like everybody is super busy and super excited. I must admit, this week has not felt as productive as it could have done for me. Mostly I think it's because last week I actually recorded my episode a day later than usual. I usually record on a Sunday and upload on a Monday, but I recorded on a Monday and did all of my editing and my uploading on Monday. So essentially I've lost a day from my creative week this week. It just means that this week's episode is slightly more short and sweet than usual, but as always, it is completely stuffed to the gills with crafty goodness. Before we get started, I do have one small announcement about the knit-along that's currently taking place on this podcast, which is the Voidalong that I am currently hosting with lovely, lovely, amazing, gorgeous Eric of the Sticks Plus Twine podcast. Eric and I are currently hosting the Voidalong until the 17th of July, so it is coming up now. You've got maybe a couple of weeks left to get one of these on and off the needles. Basically, the only thing that you need to do is to knit a Void Shawl and comment in either Eric or my podcast groups on Ravel to do with the Voidalong. And something that I have decided this past week is that I will not be opening a finished objects thread for the Voidalong. I think everyone who's been taking part is just as eligible for prizes, and I think you're all awesome. So I will be drawing my prizes from the chatter thread. And in terms of prizes, both Eric and I will be giving a gift card of your choice. So you can literally pick. If we can get a gift card for you for a particular thing, then we will get that for you. In terms of what Eric is offering, he is offering $50, that's Canadian dollars, and I am going to be offering a 25 English pound voucher. So we'll be able to get that to you for whatever it is that you want that voucher for. We're also both going to be doing a kind of
of Eric and Katie's choice kind of prize. The gift certificate will be drawn as we usually do by random number generator, but the Eric and Katie's choice is going to be a special prize for someone that we think has, you know, who is really deserving of a prize, because sometimes in knit-alongs there are people that just take your breath away for whatever reason, and you know, I think that makes you deserving of a special prize. My super, super special prize has been donated by the incredibly talented Hannah of Circus Tonic Handmade. She has donated 2 skeins of her Scarlet Honey Eater colourway yarn, and they are absolutely stunning. I love Hannah and everything she does. I love this yarn. We're so happy to have it. So thank you, Hannah. And get involved with the Voidalong, you guys. Love it, love it, love it, love it. And I'm pretty much convinced that you will love it too. So I'm gonna start off this week with, what am I wearing? And you may have noticed that I'm wearing something a little bit different this week. This hasn't made an appearance on the podcast thus far. And this is a me-made shirtwaist dress. So this dress I actually made from an original 1950s dress pattern. It's not a pattern that I actually own anymore. I'm not entirely sure where it went. It may have got lost in the various moves that Emrys and I did from our flat to my parents' house to here. You know, a lot of things have kind of gone walkabout during that process, so I can't find it to actually share it with you. But it is quite a simple, slim fit shirt waist dress. Oh, try saying that quickly in 3 times. So the main structure of the dress is a fitted bodice. It has a nipped in waist and then a very slim fit skirt. I'll try adding in a couple of maybe pictures of the full length of this dress. But yeah, it's special to me because it was one of my first ever dresses that I made from an original vintage pattern, from a 1950s pattern that I adapted. I had to actually do very little in order to kind of make this fit well, which was when I started to realise that my body type is very much more kind of a 40s and 50s shape than a modern fit, which means that vintage patterns do tend to work well on my figure. But the other lovely thing about this is that this fabric as well is original vintage fabric, which I believe I found in a vintage fair in London. They sometimes do sell kind of fabric as well as clothing. So I found this fabric. It's really, really cute. It's covered in books. You may not be able to see, but it's actually all books and they all have different titles. There's Shakespeare and different titles in there. So being a former bookworm and a reformed bookworm who's very much getting into reading again, I love having a dress that's absolutely covered in books. So that is what I am wearing today. So seeing as this is a knitting and sewing and all of that kind of stuff podcast, I think it would be a good idea to get on with What's on My Needles, which is of course the knitting segment of my podcast. I've been a relatively monogamous knitter this week, you guys. Pretty much all of my time has gone on one project. So I don't have a huge multitude of different projects to share with you this week. I know that last week I did promise that I would be casting on a new pair of socks. Lovely Nessa, my friend Nessa of the Kiltercraft podcast, has released the most beautiful I Heart Bees sock pattern, which I'm itching to get cast on. But my yarn is still sitting up here in my stash. I still haven't even caked it up. I will do. I'm going to do that as a treat for myself, I think probably this afternoon, but I have not as yet cast those socks on. And the reason that I haven't cast those on is that I was determined to get at least one sock off the needles before I cast on a new pair. Guys, I've got a ho, 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 ho. It's like a Christmas sock. Oh, that's ridiculous. Isn't it gorgeous? This is, of course, the Zigzagular sock pattern. Oh, isn't it beautiful? It is a pattern by Susie White, who is half of the Prairie Girls Knits audio podcast, which I also really love. I'm always going on about how much I love it on this podcast, but it's a great audio podcast. And this is the Zigzagular sock pattern, as I said, as I like to call it, my boy who lived sock, as it's very much lightning scar themed. This yarn was a gift from my lovely, lovely friend Jen, who gifted this to me in a yarn swap that we did, the Knitting Expat yarn swap, which is obviously hosted by Mina of the Knitting Expat podcast. words are not coming easily to me today, but I have completed the first sock and I'm really happy because this has been on my needles for such a long time. The yarn has stellina in it, it's gloriously glitzy and amazing. Interesting thing about this sock is that the actual leg of the sock is considerably shorter than I usually do it, and I really think that I prefer this. I prefer it to have a slightly shorter leg. For one thing, it's nicer to knit because you don't feel that you're knitting for years and years and years and years and years before you do anything, but also I feel that it fits better. This sock, this pattern, has given me the nicest fit of a sock that I've probably ever knit. And I think some of that is probably to do with the fact that the zigzag pattern is almost like ribbing, so it does kind of grip your leg a little bit. But I'm really happy with this, and I could definitely see myself using this pattern again in the future. By the way, talking about my I Heart Bees socks that I'm going to be doing with Nessa's amazing pattern, I have found the most incredible mini that I think I'm going to use for the toes and the heels. How cute! How cute! And how pretty! How pretty is this? Oh my goodness. Just perfect. Excitement of new projects. Excitement, excitement. That's going back in its house. There we go. So moving on from hose, half-finished objects, to works in progress. I have one this week, you guys. One work in progress. And this is the one that I have been giving the majority of my time to. It's living in my fondant fibre project bag, my Happiness is Homemade project bag. And it is my Featherweight cardigan. Look at it. It's very creased from being in the little project bag, but look at how much I have done. I have done the entire body and I am now on the rib section at the base. So I'm now onto my ribs. Isn't it beautiful? I am in love. I want to make 100 of these. And it fits like a dream, it really, really does. I would say I have had to do some alterations to the pattern, not major alterations, just adding more length. The Featherweight cardigan, by its nature, is quite cropped, and I do like cropped cardigans, I do enjoy them, but with something like this that is so open at the front, I felt to have it very cropped, kind of high on my waist, just felt really weird, like really insubstantial. Rather than going for the suggested 8.5 inches of work, I actually added a couple of extra inches onto the length in order to just have a little more coverage over my back. So even though it's quite light and open when I wear it, I'll still feel that there is some substance to it. Featherweight cardigan by Hannah Fettig, an incredibly popular pattern to knit, and to be perfectly honest, from working on it I can see why. It's so intuitive, it's a really good starter project for a cardigan because it's designed to sit fairly open so there are no fastenings to worry about. There's very little shaping once you've got past the armholes, once you've actually, oops, got my waist here untangled up. Once you've got past the armhole shaping, you literally just kind of stockinette stitch all the way down to when you get to the rib. So it's very, very simple. It's a real pleasure to knit on. It's quite brainless in a really, really like pleasurable way. You don't have to think too much when you're working on this. And I just love it. The yarn, of course, is my absolute favorite. This yarn is Voolevine Yarns. It's her Gashley Crumb colorway. And it's on her Volca base, which is an MCM Merino Cashmere Nylon. This is my cake. Forgive how it's a little bit scraggly. I think my ball winder was having a funny 5 minutes when I wound this. It's beautiful. I love it so much. This is my second skein of yarn. I purchased 3 skeins for this cardigan. And if I can just show you, I didn't get to the second skein until here. If you can see my little 2 bits of yarn that I've lightly knotted together before I sew in the ends. So I managed to get the entire body of a Featherweight cardigan out of 100 grams skein of Voolevine Yarns, which I'm really, really impressed with. I thought that was pretty amazing. I just can't say enough good things about the Featherweight cardigan. I know that it's going to be something that I'm going to want to wear all the time because it's light enough to wear it when it's warmer, but it would also be very, very easy to layer it up with slightly warmer garments underneath it for autumn and possibly even winter. I am knitting it on my higher sharps, my 3.5 millimeter higher sharps, which are a US 4. I did have to, as I said previously, adjust my needle size. I went down 2 needle sizes to get gauge for this project. Another thing I would like to talk about, kind of related to my Featherweight, is a little present that actually was sent to me by Jen, who also sent the yarn for my socks that I have recently finished the first one. And that is this little chap. Isn't he fun? This is something that I know that a lot of people have. It is by Susan Bates and it is a stitch or row counter, and it has this little ring kind of thing at the bottom. You pop it on your finger, you wear it like this as you're knitting, and every time you finish a row or whatever you're trying to count, you press your little button and it counts it. And oh my goodness, you guys, my life has changed. My life has changed. And all I can say, Jen, who sent me this, thank you so much. I'm enjoying using this so much. It's just, it makes the whole process of finishing a row even more enjoyable because you get to press your little button on here. Even Emrys loves it. Emrys loves getting involved and being like, have you finished the row? Can I press the button now? I really, really enjoy using it. And it looks quite cute. It looks like the type of jewellery that I used to wear as a child. Big, massive, plastic, chunky rings and stuff. So yes, big, big fan of this. Moving on from knitting, I think it's about time for So What? Which is of course the sewing segment of the podcast. Now this week, I must admit, I have done pretty much zero sewing. The sewing that I do is mostly dependent on shifts that I'm working at work, and it just so happens that my shifts for this particular week have made it pretty much impossible for me to have the time to sit down and sew, which is super disappointing. I'm really not happy about it, and it's something that I'm going to hopefully rectify in the next week or so. But there is something sewing based that I want to talk to you guys about, so I thought what better segment than So What to discuss this interesting and exciting idea. Well, it was an idea last week. Now it's formulated into a plan. It's a plan now. So if you tuned into the podcast last week, you'll know that I posed the question, would people be interested in doing a sew along with me, which also involved video tutorials and how-tos as to how to do different things in terms of the project that we're working on. And you guys, the response has been incredible. I think universally, pretty much every message or comment that I've received over the last week has been, yes, please, let's do a sew along. It's an amazing idea. So thank you, first of all, for such a positive response. It's really, really lovely when you put something out there to get such an incredible feeling of welcome back from you. So thank you from that. So the sew along will definitely be happening. It will be starting in August, so that's going to give me a month to get my stuff together and formulate a proper plan. I've been spending the majority of the time that I would have been sewing kind of jotting down ideas and formulating a schedule, because we got to be organized for this type of thing. I don't want to talk about it too much this week. I just want to let you know it will definitely be happening. And the project that I have decided that we will be working on is the Roeburn skirt. This is a sewaholic pattern, and it is something that a lot of you suggested and said that you would be interested in making. The reason I've picked this pattern is, for one, it's from an indie sewing pattern designer, which is really important to me. I like to support smaller businesses rather than just going for the big mainstream brands. The other great thing about this particular pattern is it is available as a paper pattern, but also as a PDF download. So if you are not necessarily in a place that has these readily available, or it's going to take a long time for it to get to you, or you're going to have to pay huge amounts of postage, you can always go for the PDF one, download it onto your computer and print it out. It's a lot more convenient, and it's something that I really enjoy doing with a lot of patterns. It's a really, really simple design. It's kind of an A-line flared skirt. It comes in 3 different lengths. It also has pockets. and you all know how much I love pockets. And it has a couple of different variations for detailing around the waist, which adds a little bit of intrigue. I think this is a great pattern for a beginner because it's not particularly complicated, but I do think in terms of additional techniques and fun things that you could add into the process of making this skirt, even if you're an intermediate or advanced sewer, you're still going to find something fun, something that you can add that's extra. And I'm really, really looking forward to getting started on this, you guys. So in the meantime, I would say if you're interested, go ahead and purchase a copy of the pattern. Get excited because it's going to be awesome. It's something completely new for me. It's not something that I've ever done before. And I couldn't be more excited about the challenges of putting this together for you guys. So watch this space. So excited, pun intended. So for anyone who's maybe a little disappointed that So What hasn't had any physical, actual sewing in it this week, I have decided to introduce a new segment this week. And this is actually a segment that quite a few of you have asked for in the past. So for the first time ever this week, it's time for
From the Vaults.
And if you can't tell from the rather dramatic title, this is me looking back at projects that I've made in the past and showing you a completed garment, be it knitting or sewing based, and showing you some of the techniques I've used. So this week in From the Vaults, I'm going to be sharing with you one of my favourite sewing projects that I have ever completed. Genuinely, this was kind of one of the more challenging projects that I've done, but it makes me happy in so many different ways, and I'm really, really excited to share it with you this week. It is a dress, and it was made from this pattern, which is one of the Gertie patterns for Butterick. It is number B5882, and it's this beautiful shelf bust dress. I will insert some full length images of me wearing this dress, but it's something that I completed, I think, 3 years ago now. A lot of people say that they knit because of the process rather than the end product, even though you love the end product. And the way that I feel about this dress is very similar. I absolutely adored every single second of the process of making this dress, and I'm going to show you why. So I'm going to warn you right now, this is a disclaimer that the information that's going to be coming up about this garment is going to be technical. I love getting technical about sewing. I love different techniques. I like finding out fun things. I like learning new things all the time. It's the type of thing that makes me happy in the sewing that I'm doing. So that's why I am being a little bit self-indulgent. And I hope you enjoy it. I understand it's not for everyone, but I honestly think it is absolutely fascinating. So let's get on with it. So this is my dress. How amazing is it? The fabric that I picked is pinup girls. Check out those pretty pinup girls. Isn't it gorgeous? It is a 7-piece bodice, which is these pieces under here. Then you also cut out the bust parts, which are pleated and sewn in place. And then you have the straps, which basically go from the very back of the garment all the way across and around the front. I am actually really proud as well of how I cut the fabric for the bodice, because I specifically wanted each of the panel pieces to have a pin-up lady on them. And they all do, every single piece. So yay. The skirt is a very full skirt, which again is pieced, I believe. There are the same amount of pieces in the skirt as there are on the bodice. So I believe that there are 7 pieces, but they are considerably bigger because this dress has an incredibly full skirt. Looks relatively simple to the naked eye, but the thing that I love about this dress is kind of what's going on inside it. So the first detail that I'm going to show you is the zip. This is a lapped zipper, which was incredibly popular in the 50s. And basically it means that your zipper is hidden behind this nice little lap of fabric. There it is. It's a really, really nice design element. But let me show you what's going on inside my garment. So this dress is fully lined. And when I say fully lined, it's lined from the top all the way down to the bottom of the skirt. And there are lots of different layers going on in here. First and foremost, I'm gonna show you what's going on inside the bodice. And yes, we have bra cups. I wear this dress without any bra because it's fully boned. It has a fully boned bodice, so it's basically like wearing a corset. And it also has these bra cups that are sewn into the dress, which gives a little bit of added lift and support because, you know, boobs. The really exciting part of the bodice is the boning channels. So if you can see here, I have boning channels throughout the bodice. There's some here, there's some here, some in the centre. These channels are sewn into the lining. So this red cotton lining is where I've sewn my boning channels. Oh, one of my bra cups is loose. Oh well, I'll have to sew that down later. But the if you can see the lines, those are where all my boning channels have been sewn in. And each one of these channels has a piece of spiral steel boning in it, which I have cut to size. You then sew the little channel in your lining fabric, you pop in your boning, and then when you sew the lining to your bodice, it creates this neatly enclosed little channel for your boning piece. And you may not be able to see because the stitches are so tiny, but I hand stitched the lining along here. So the waist lining is all hand stitched. So that's what's going on in terms of the bodice. It's quite a heavy piece, as you can imagine. It has those bra cups, it has the fashion fabric, it has lining, it has what felt like 100 different strips of spiral steel boning. So it is a hefty piece of garment. When you actually hold it, you can understand why it gives this kind of really shaped structure. But the skirt also has a whole array of different linings going on. So first of all, it's also fully lined with the red cotton fabric. I basically cut out the skirt entirely in the red cotton fabric as well, which basically means that it has a nice soft layer next to the skin, so next to the legs when you're wearing it. And why you would need a nice soft layer next to your legs will soon become apparent when I show you what's going on next to the fashion fabric. So I am a huge fan of a poofy skirt, and one of the easiest ways to do that without wearing a massive petticoat underneath is to use horsehair braid. So this used to be originally made of horsehair, but you can now buy different varieties of horsehair braid, which is made with plastic. The wider the horsehair braid that you use, the more flare your skirt will have. And I use some big horsehair braid on this. Look at the width of that. So this is my horsehair braid here. Can you see that? And it's this kind of netting. It's very difficult to show up on the camera, but you can kind of see here, it's a netting structure. And what you do is you sew that to your fashion fabric, you then turn it up to hem it, and you use a herringbone stitch, so this little crossy stitch. You can see here all these tiny little crosses to sew that to your skirt in order to hold it in place. It's a great stitch to use for a hem, the herringbone stitch, because it's flexible. So if you just use a straight stitch, if someone were to pull on your skirt, and a lot of the time skirts do get pulled because they're a movable part of the garment, they're not designed to be stiff, it can break your stitches and your hem can unravel. If you use this stitch, the herringbone stitch, because it's by its nature, it's movable, it's flexible, it means that if someone were to tread on your skirt and pull the hem, it's not necessarily going to rip, because the hem itself moves in the same way that the fabric does. In order to create a garment that didn't have any marks on the external fabric, so the actual fashion fabric, which I didn't want to have even tiny stitches showing on that, I used an interlining of organza. So I have this very, very pale blue organza, which I sewed hand basted to each piece of the skirt. And therefore, when I sewed my horsehair braid up, I sewed it to the organza rather than the fashion fabric, which meant I then had no stitches on the outside of the skirt. I warned you it was going to be technical. The one last feature that I would like to show of the dress before we move on to other things is one of my favourite seam finishes. The seam finish that I used on the skirt is something called a turned seam. You can see my seams here. And the way that I finished them was to press them flat, to press them under again, and then to sew. So if you can see here, there is a line of sewing down the edge of my seam, which is basically a way of just binding off any raw edges of, for this garment, the organza and the fashion fabric all in one. And it takes quite a long time, because essentially you are sewing every seam three times, because you're sewing it to fix it. So you're sewing it originally to sew the two pieces of the skirt together. And then when you're pressing that seam down and turning it under, you are again sewing that seam on one side and the other side to get this really neat finish. It's a favorite of mine because you don't need any additional equipment in order to do it. You literally just need to continue using the foot and the setting of the sewing machine that you've been using to sew the rest of the pieces of the garment. So you don't have to, you know, get a serger out or even get pinking shears out to do it. It's all done on the same machine that you've been using, which I find incredibly convenient. I think the finish is beautiful. It's one of my favorites. So that's my dress, you guys. I hope that you've enjoyed finding out a little bit more about the sewing process of this garment. It's something, like I said, that I absolutely loved making, and to this day it's one of my favourite things that I have ever made. I really need to find something to wear this to. Next time I'm going on a fancy event, I'm gonna wear this dress. Because I love it. Okay guys, like I said, it was probably going to be a little bit of a short and sweet episode this week. I have one more segment left to do, but in terms of all of the crafting and the sewing and all of that good stuff, that's all finished. The last segment that I have to do is obviously my general waffle segment. I thought it was about time that a guest that I've had recently made a reappearance on the podcast, as you all seemed to enjoy it when he came along last time. So I am now going to hand over for the rest of this episode to Katie of the past, because we actually did this little bit of recording that's about to come up yesterday, and a very glamorous assistant who is going to be with her. So I'm going to pass over to them, and I hope you enjoy this week's General Waffle. That was disappointing.
What's the fun fact?
Human thigh bones are stronger than concrete.
It's true.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
And welcome back to another edition. I suppose it's an edition.
Okay.
Of General Waffle.
General Waffle. Waffle.
And due to the success of my previous General Waffle with this one.
Oh, go on.
With my husband, Emrys, I decided to invite him back. Aren't you all so lucky to have him back for another General Waffle? But he's excited to be here, I think. Are you excited?
Yeah.
And we have fun beverages, which we just bought from the supermarket. What's your fun beverage?
Mine is a fruit punch Gatorade, which, if you're watching from the US, is just something you can buy in any shop. But in this country, imported, rare,
and expensive,
special.
And
that's
I got a Schnapple, which is pink lemonade. Which pink lemonade is probably one of my favourite flavours of anything.
Okay.
Because I love lemon flavoured things. I'm very into citrus fruits, citrus flavoured things, but also pink. Pink makes it better. I didn't think I'd like it that much.
Where'd you get it then?
Because I thought it would look nice. But the thing about drinks is that you always finish my drinks anyway, don't you?
Yeah. For those of you keeping score at home, you'll notice that I've had quite a lot more of my drink already than Katie. And if you keep watching the drinks throughout this video, you'll notice mine will go like this. And Katie's will go like this.
Mine will stay basically the same.
And that's all she'll have.
So for my waffle this week, we're actually doing something a little bit differently. For those of you who are new to the podcast, this section is usually when I kind of just waffle on about any particular topic that I want to talk about. It doesn't have to be related to yarn and fabric and sewing and crafty goodness. Emrys and I are actually going to be doing a YouTube tag today. Do you know what a YouTube tag is?
No idea.
For those of you that don't watch a lot of other YouTube videos other than podcasts like this one, basically these tags do the rounds on different YouTube channels and different people kind of take it up as a challenge. So I thought it might be fun to kind of start this tag within the knitting podcasting community, because I think it's quite funny and it's enjoyable to watch, and there are a lot of, you know, duo podcasters that could probably do this tag, or if you're significant other doesn't mind coming onto your podcast, then you could, you know, try this out as well. Mm-hmm. So I thought that might be a bit fun. So the tag that we are going to be doing this week is called the couples 1-2-3 tag. Let me read you the rules. You and your significant other count to 1-2-3 and answer this question, whatever the question is, at the same time. And the questions are basically about different things to do with the other person, mm-hmm. but you both give your answer at the same time. So for example, we will ask a question. So the question may be, what is your significant other's favorite color? You then count to three, and first of all, you answer for one of them. So we would both answer for me. Mm-hmm. And then we do the same for the other person. So we would both answer for, oh, I just poked you in the neck. I'm so sorry.
It's okay.
Both answer for Emrys. I hope that makes sense. I think it will become a lot more clear as we actually do the tag though. So yeah. So should we just jump right in?
Yeah, let's do it.
So it says boyfriend / girlfriend, but we're obviously married. So
you could do it with your friend as well.
Yeah,
so it doesn't have to be just for a couple.
BFF.
Yeah.
So the first question is, if your boyfriend / girlfriend, husband / wife,
yeah,
could be married to a movie star, who would it be?
Oh, God.
So you're thinking of an answer for me?
Yeah.
I think you're going to be surprised, though, by my answer. It's quite difficult thinking who it would be for myself, actually.
One, two, three.
Johnny Depp is very true. I used to be very much in love with Johnny Depp. Mostly due, I think, to his older films, so like Edward Scissorhands. I have a real soft spot to this
day.
Yeah,
remember when he was good and Tim Burton was good? Those were good times.
But yeah, did you hear what I said?
You said David Tennant.
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, I'm happy with that.
And you know why?
Why? Because he's in Jessica Jones, and he's an evil. You always like the bad characters. I'd be fine if you got married to David Tennant.
I've got
to think of one for me now, haven't I?
I've already got one for you. I've got two for you, actually.
One, two, three.
Amelia Clark.
Yes, I would. Yes,
and
I would
totally marry Amelia Clark too.
Yeah, I was going topical. Yeah. I haven't seen Kat Dennings in anything for a while.
Yeah, but you are a little bit. It was either going to be Kat Dennings or Emma Stone. So yeah, I'd be totally down with you marrying Amelia Clark and me marrying David Tennant, as long as we could still hang out.
Maybe as a foursome. That'd be awesome.
Awesome foursome.
An awesome foursome.
Okay.
You can cut that out too.
If your husband or wife could be a celebrity, who would it be?
Okay.
Oh, this is hard. Oh, I know. I know who I would want to be. And you won't be able to guess it.
Brilliant. Okay.
Okay. One, two, three.
Lin-Manuel Miranda.
Was that your guess for me?
Yeah.
Oh, so, I would like to be Lin-Manuel.
You know,
Miranda.
That is, J.K. Rowling is actually the first one I thought of, and then I
really?
Went, this is a funnier one, so I'm going to say this one.
Yeah, J.K. Rowling. I would love to be her, and she will always be affiliated with Harry Potter, which is like the coolest thing of all time. And like, if that's the only thing anyone ever remembers you for in your life, you're like, that is awesome. I'm the Harry Potter person. You know, like that should be on like your gravestone, the Harry Potter person.
Or something, you know, better.
One, two, three. Aaron Sorkin.
That's good. I can totally be Don Oliver. Yeah. I'm British, I've got glasses, brown hair.
Is that all it takes to be John Oliver?
Apparently.
Yeah, John Oliver's a very good choice. Mm. But Aaron Sorkin, I thought, because, you know...
We both chose writery kind of people.
We're very into that right now, apparently. Yeah. Writers and... But yeah, he's a writer and a director, though. That's why I...
Aaron Sorkin?
Yeah.
He's not a director.
Is he not?
Nope.
I thought he was a director. I made a wrong choice. Okay. Oh, this is a good one.
Yeah.
This is very American, though, so it's quite funny. You've gone to the 7-Eleven. What's the 7-Eleven?
Convenience store.
It's a corner shop. Yeah. Okay, we've gone to the corner shop, as we do here, to get milk.
Mm-hmm.
Got milk.
Did that today.
Yeah, and decide to buy your significant other a treat. What did you buy? I know already what I'm going to say. So you've gone to buy milk and you've got to get me a treat.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
One, two, three.
Red Bull. Yes! Come on! Everyone's got to have some kind of vice, and that is yours.
That's my vice. Yeah. But I don't smoke and drink and do drugs.
Red Bull is technically a drug because it's got caffeine in it.
Yeah, but...
not like drugs.
I do gentle drugs.
One, two, three, sweets. Yeah, there you go.
That was good.
When it comes to food, we know.
We know each other. Okay. What percentage of housework would your significant other say that they do?
Oh, no.
So how much housework would I say that I do, first of all?
One, two, three, 80%. I don't feel like I can celebrate that.
1, 2, 3, 50%.
Yeah, I don't feel like I can celebrate getting that one right.
No. At least we understand each other in that respect.
In the sense that we don't understand.
In the fact that we don't agree with how much housework we do.
Right, moving on.
Okay. If your significant other could choose one thing for you to get rid of, what would it be? So this could open up a can of worms, couldn't it? Because you'll be like, you want me to get rid of my blank?
But I love my blank.
One, two, three.
Action figures.
I don't mind your action figures.
No, I mean all the ones I have to sell in the other room.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay, yeah, that's true. That's the truth. You know me better.
I want to get rid of those posters as well. You know.
Yeah, those posters. But it's not necessarily the posters.
Like, I'm nearly 30. I feel like I'm not the kind of person who has posters on the wall anymore. Just for those of you who are keeping tabs at home. That's what I have left. That's what she has left.
I'm a camel. I retain liquid for long periods of time.
And I'm a radiator. I retain heat for long periods of time. That's your new name for the podcast. Yeah.
What? The camel and the radiator. Oh, God. Okay, so we're going to answer it for what you think I should get rid of.
One, two, three. Unnecessary kitchen stuff.
As far as I'm concerned, there's no such thing as unnecessary kitchen stuff.
There you go. I finished my drink.
I haven't had half of my drink yet.
She hasn't had any more since we pretty much started it.
No, I had a little sip.
Yeah, a little sip.
And a little thinking sip. Mm. This is a good one. Mm-hmm. What is your significant other's ultimate favourite movie?
Oh, that's easy.
Yeah.
One, two, three. The Princess Bride.
Oh.
Yeah.
Shameful.
Yeah.
One, two, three. About time. See, I love About Time.
That's my favourite movie.
My favourite movie. Not that you knew that.
I just thought I'd go for something that wasn't obvious.
Yeah, but I don't even think if I had like a top five, The Princess Bride may not be in that top five.
Really?
It'd be in the top 10, most definitely. But right now, at this point in my life, I don't think it would make the top five.
Okay.
That's an interesting discussion. Maybe we could do that in the future.
That's a good, I would be up for that.
What do you guys think?
Should we do it?
Comments below. If you think
I like when people do that in YouTube videos. Just comment right here.
Just comment below.
Yeah.
A meteor just hit. You've saved everything important. What would your significant other go back to get? Oh, that would be interesting. Rolly is definitely safe and he's outside of the building. Mm-hmm. He's fine.
Mm.
And I think we should also say that both our phones and our computers are also fine.
Yeah.
One, two, three. Simba.
Oh, I'm definitely right.
No, but he's important.
Yeah.
He's more important.
For those of you who don't know, Simba is not only a character from The Lion King, but also Katie's long-term stuffed companion.
I had him since I was 7.
Yeah.
Aww.
So basically what she's saying is, Yarn is more important than Simba.
I didn't buy it. You're right, I would go back for Simba.
There you go.
I feel really sad that I didn't say I was going to save him from the meteor now.
Yeah, look how sad he is.
So gross.
One, two, three. Media server. There you go.
Yeah, there's no point in having the computer unless you have the server as well, yeah. Is there? Because you don't have anything on your computer.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm still feeling really mean about Simba.
You should be. Look how sad he is over there.
He'll never forgive me for this. Okay, there's only one left.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
The saying, opposites attract, is true because me and my significant other are opposite at blank. So what we're saying is the thing that we are opposite at. Should we change it up this time and both just say what we think that we're opposite at and see whether or not it's the same?
Okay.
We're going crazy. We're making up our own rules now.
Breaking
the tag, but you know
what
I always say? It's my podcast. It's my rules.
That's correct.
I can break the rules.
And I'm here.
And you're here because I allow you to be.
Okay.
Okay, ready?
Mm-hmm. One, two, three. You're clean, I'm tidy. Ah!
That's so true.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
That is the thing we're different with. For me, it's all about I want it to be neat and everything's got its place. Mm-mm. And for you, it's like I actually want it to be clean.
I want it to be clean.
Probably is more important, but my brain goes there.
I don't want us to die of like salmonella or something like that.
Yeah.
Because I tend to have shall we say, an organised chaos situation going on. Mm-hmm.
The places that I've found her phone. I found it in the fridge once. I'm not even joking.
But I do love organising things. Mm. Like, I love organising things.
And I don't dislike being clean, just to be clear.
I think what we have proved is that you don't necessarily have to have identical answers in order to know what the other person is thinking. Mm-hmm. Because I think it shows we know each other quite well because we have agreed on everything.
And some
like sometimes you knew better than me.
Yeah.
And for everyone who's still keeping score, I've still got that much left in there.
Mine is finished.
Do you want it?
Yes.
So that's everything for another week, you guys. Thank you so much for watching, as always. If you've enjoyed the video, please like it, give it thumbs up. Please subscribe. Thank you. Please subscribe to the video below. I do upload every Monday, but I also upload little intermittent videos every so often. So if you subscribe, you're always going to get notifications that they're there. So yay! I want to thank Emrys for coming and being on the podcast again. Thank you for being a good sport and indulging me in terms of getting you to do random things on the podcast. And also in terms of the couples 1, 2, 3 tag, I am basically tagging every podcaster that I know. Please do feel free to take part, or not if you don't want to, in the couples tag. Like we say, it's something that you could do with your co-host if you have a co-host, or with your husband or your wife or your girlfriend or your boyfriend or just a friend. I think it'd be funny to see what people's different answers are, but I will post a list of all of the questions down below, so answer as many or as few of those questions as you would like. For now, I hope you all have an amazing week. I will obviously see you next Monday. I just want to say happy sewing, happy knitting, and I will see you all again soon. Bye. What is your significant other's most used cuss word? Or as we like to say in the UK, swear word.
Are you going to like bleep it out?
Okay. You're going to bleep it out.
How are people going to know what it is?
We'll just tell them if we got it the same. For me.
Yeah.
One, two, three.
Okay.
We didn't get it right.
Mm-mm.
One, two, three.
Yeah.
I'm gonna cut that one out.
Yeah, I told you.